Hello and welcome to this revision guide then to Paper 1, Section B, the Narrative or Creative Writing element. Today we're going to focus on setting. What is setting? Well, the place your story is set, the situation where most of the action takes place. Here's a copy of the exam paper then. You'll see as normal you get four options to choose from and you've got to come up with a narrative that suits one of those four options. It's been graded for AO5, Communication and Organisation out of 24 marks, and AO6, Vocab, Sentence Structure, Spelling and Punctuation out of 16 marks. Gives you a total then of 40. Here's a copy of the exam criteria. Band 5 is the highest band, so that's your grade 7 to 9s. Band 4 and high band 3 is likely to be your high grade pass, with band 3 and lower coming in at your grade 4 or below. You can see words there such as characterization, originality and imagination for the highest bands, but just to pass it you need just to control your story, develop your character or situation and use a variety of sentence structure and a range of punctuation. So quite straightforward, but it does involve quite a level of creative thinking, I suppose, on the actual exam day. So setting. The first paragraph of any story should set the scene and create atmosphere. Here we're going to call this the setting paragraph, as it is where you'd want to engage or hook the reader into your story. Here's a video then to give you a bit of guidance.
Plants everywhere will die, and the animals that depend on them will starve, and the animals that eat those will starve. Winter will come early and hard, and it will last a long, long time. It will end, of course, like every winter does, and then the world will return to its old self. Eventually. Eventually. The people of the stillness live in a perpetual state of disaster preparedness. They built walls and dug wells and put away food, and they can easily last 5, 10, even 25 years in a world without sun. Eventually, meaning in this case, in a few thousand years. Look, the ash clouds are spreading already. This is from the prologue of The Fifth Season by N.K. Jemisin, which won the Hugo Award for Best Novel in 2016. In this universe, the planet undergoes apocalyptic seasons every few centuries. The sky is dotted with mysterious obelisks described as massive crystalline shards that hover amid the clouds, rotating slowly and drifting along incomprehensible flight paths. Origins, people with the power to move the earth, are persecuted in this world. You can see how all the elements of the story connect back to one key feature, setting. We have the backdrop, a world that faces constant earthquakes. From that springs the plot of a society trying to survive environmental catastrophe. Then we have main characters that face discrimination because of their unique ability to control these earthquakes. A well-chosen setting adds to the story in some way. Let's explore how various authors in both genre and realistic fiction have enhanced their work by emphasizing the character's larger surroundings. We'll examine setting in terms of survival stories, time period, different cultures, common tropes, and characterization. Like in The Fifth Season, many survival stories feature settings integral to the plot, the natural environment serving as an antagonist. In The Long Winter by Laura Ingalls Wilder, harsh blizzards in Dakota Territory cut off a town from food and supplies, and the characters must save their family from starvation. Writing survival stories like this can be exciting because epidemics and natural disasters immediately put the characters in danger. The setting throws people out of their comfort zones and strips humanity down to its core qualities.
As you can see then, lots of ideas that setting can link to character, situation, atmosphere, as well as a whole range of emotions too. You really planning your setting and using it well really enhances your story for the examiner to grade very, very highly. So what are the expectations for a setting paragraph? Setting paragraph should clearly use similes, alliteration and other descriptive devices. Use developed vocab, the highest vocab you know how to use. A range of punctuation. Details described in more than a sentence. And it's likely to be around about half a side of A4 in total. That way it allows you to give the detail the examiner requires. You can see an example there on the bottom describing a thunderstorm. You can see the vocab choices there, the range of punctuation, and I've tried to make it sound as interesting as possible. Here's another example taken from the novel At Least Once by Maurice Glitzman. This is now describing an orphanage and someone's experience in that orphanage. Notice the paragraphs are split up. Some sentences are left on their own as almost individual paragraphs. And you can see it's deliberately appealing to the reader using phrases like "you know how" when a nun served you. It puts you right into the story and begins to describe from the character's perspective what's going on around them. Here's another example setting paragraph then, this one from My Antonia by Willia Cather. There seemed to be nothing to see, no fences, no creeks or trees or hills nor fields. There was a road, but I could not make it out in the faint starlight. There was nothing but land, and not a country at all, but the material out of which countries are made. I had the feeling that the world is left behind and that we got over the edge of it and we're just outside man's jurisdiction. You can see in this case, setting's been described as being desolate, with nothing around. Equally though, even a desolate landscape can be described to create atmosphere to get the sense of loneliness across to the reader. So, to describe something well, what do I need to do? Well, one of the first things you need to do is think about your senses.
Appealing to the reader's senses. Okay, for this we need another exam task. Describe your nightmare world. And, my nightmare world is kind of big children's party with big fluffy characters and screaming kids everywhere, yeah? That would work. I can describe that really well. I can make it sound terrifying, those ugly smelly kids. But I'm going to do it even better if I'm not myself, nice young enthusiastic teacher, quite like kids, I really should anyway, it's part of the job. Instead, I'm going to be this big grumpy Victor Meldrew type character, grouchy old man, wants nothing to do with any of it, because you can see the conflict between the two. It's a really happy place, but I'm a really miserable old sod. So I'm going to write as him. And here is the kind of thing I might write. This is a nightmare too horrible to imagine. A world which just does not bear thinking about, let alone describing. Your ears are constantly assaulted by the whining, shrieking laughter of happy children. What can they possibly have to be happy about? Stuffing their snotty faces with lurid, pink, foul-tasting confections of every variety. It makes me shudder. I feel like it's a conspiracy. Even the air smells sweet and the grass beneath my feet feels somehow bouncy. Okay, so I'm describing quite a nice place, but in a really miserable, grouchy kind of way. And I'm appealing to the five senses. Have a look at this. Sense number one, your ears are constantly assaulted by the whining, shrieking laughter of happy children. Well, that's something I can hear. Then I've got something I can see, the lurid pink confections, yeah? And I mentioned how they taste, so I've got the taste in there. Down the bottom, got the air smell sweet, so there's a smell and a feeling of grass feels bouncy beneath my feet. Now, you don't want to be too unsubtle with this. If your writing becomes a list of all I could smell was, all I could taste was, all I could feel was, then it gets really dull. So you want to be throwing these in throughout because they can give more detail to your description, but don't go over the top because it gets really dull. So that is top tip number two, senses. And we're nearly there because the last two top tips are really straightforward. Top tip number three is you've got to use ambitious language. What do I mean by ambitious language? Well, first and foremost, you've got to use as wide a vocabulary as possible. I've done another video on vocabulary choices featuring these guys, the Seven Dwarfs, so I suggest you have a look at that. I'm not going to go into too much detail here, but you need to use as many ambitious words as possible. Then, think about figurative language, similes, metaphors. You can maybe use some personification, that kind of thing, because it will make your description come alive. And also think about the kind of language or tone your persona would use. So the character you've created to write as, what sort of words would they choose? So be ambitious. You want to be using some sophisticated language, but at the same time think about, well, how would they say it? Because it will give your writing that extra quality that we're looking for. So that's top tip number three, ambitious language. And our final top tip, and this is the really painfully obvious one, is you've got to write well. You're being marked on your writing, so it's so important to get the basics right. Think about your spelling. Now, don't think about spelling at the cost of vocabulary. You're better to use a difficult word and spell it slightly wrong than you are not to use that word, but you want to spell as well as you can, yeah? It is important. Paragraphing. If you do not paragraph your work, it is going to have a massive, massive impact on the grade you achieve. How do you make sure you paragraph your work? You plan it first, and I've also done another video on planning, structuring, paragraphing, so I suggest you have a look at that one if you're unsure in this area. What else do I mean? Variety of punctuation. Let's see the colons, the semicolons, the exclamation marks when they're appropriate, hyphens, brackets. All of those things will help to lift your mark. And again, there's other videos on there on my channel, so have a look at them. Focus on the task set. If you're asked to describe yourself, it's no good telling the examiner a story about when you were five and your cat got run over by a milk float, because whilst that's something about you, it's not fitting the task, which is to describe yourself. So you do have to keep that focus on the question. And again, I suggest planning will help.
Now, as you can see, I skipped the first piece of advice that he gave, because the first bit actually mentioned that you should lie. Now, in these times, the examiner's looking for more of a genuine approach. Many schools were criticised because the students write about being on the moon or being a soldier in war. So we need to make sure your story is something that could actually happen to you in a realistic sort of time frame. So be careful on sort of, don't go too mad on how much you lie and make up a situation that you've got no real experience of and so can't describe. So you need a setting that can suit any story, positive or negative. The exam would give you two positives, chances are, and two negative options in your exam. So your setting should be able to fit any one of these options so you're not caught out. A church is a really good example. On the left hand side, you can see a very somber, very sad event, which is a funeral. But on the right hand side, you can see a very happy, positive event, in this case, a wedding. The setting remains the same, though, a church for both. Now, as you can see, one of the things the man from Cooper's there emphasised was the use of senses. Look at the picture there in the background. What can you see, hear, smell and taste if you were there and that was your city around you? What could you hear? Could you hear the firemen? Could you hear the sirens? Could you hear flames? Etc, etc. Now, a bomb site is a very easy place to use the senses. So choose a setting that allows this to happen. Choose a setting then that allows you to talk about all four senses, or all five senses, sorry. You can see the smoke from a bomb site being described there, and how I might do that on the chart there. But now you might want to stop the video and fill in sights, sounds and smells. How might you use those to your advantage? As emphasised earlier, planning your answer, thinking through what you're going to write is always a good idea. You could always just develop that description further. You notice I'm beginning to use similes in my answer there to describe my senses. A simile is when you compare two objects with each other. This is used to achieve around about a grade 3 upwards. Example, the smoke clogged up his throat like a living thing, coiling round his tongue. Notice my vocab choices there, but the simile using the word like describes the smoke as being almost living. To do better than that, I might extend that into an extended simile, which means adding more detail to my original simile to emphasise its effects. So to get a grade 5 upwards, I might change that sentence to, the smoke clogged up his throat like a living thing, coiling round his tongue, its silent, deadly body coiling tighter and tighter, making him gag and sway, its ashen poison taking his life away. I then emphasise the smoke being a bit like a snake, and you can see the repetition of coiled there, and the effect on my character by this smoke sort of going down his throat. Now, by all means, try the example at the bottom, the road stretched on forever, like. What could you add on the bottom there to make the simile, and then how could you extend that simile further? Think of a really good simile for your own setting, and then try and add a bit more detail to it. So as I said, I can now add that, make that even better to go into the higher grades, grade 7 or better. I might now add to my original simile by saying, my throat grew tight, the smoke curled down my larynx, rubbing against my throat like a disease. I choked, gasped and shuddered. Magic 3 vocab choices there. The taste was at once reminiscent of my dad's, crossed out, no father's barbecue and bonfire night. Yet this was a bonfire of people's homes. In this case, I've gone back in time into my hometown there, in this case a picture of Southampton, and I've deliberately tried to use the language to emphasise the time. So I wouldn't have called my dad dad in those days, I would have called him father, hence the change I've made and the self-editing there. Here's another really good setting, in this case a hospital. Again, could be a scene of some really positive memories as well as some quite dark ones. Here's some examples of some of the details I might want to pick out if I was describing it. Now, each one of those sentence beginnings could be turned positive or negative to give you a bit of guidance on how to write about, in this case, a hospital. Now, you've just created a sensory description with those sentences that could have gone positive or negative, but the situation, the picture there I've shown you, photograph I've shown you there, emphasizes light. It's quite a light picture, so you might well have gone quite positive. Obviously, the same setting could easily be changed to add a much darker atmosphere. Still a hospital, but there's no doubt now that I'm going much more for a gothic story than a happy or pleasant one. Now, one of the difficulties students often have is, well, where do I get the detail from? There's not actually much in that picture to actually describe. So what would I want to do? How would I pick out what details are worth talking about? Well, one way of doing it would be to put a grid over the top. Picture it as if you're zooming in on particular squares of the picture. Think about what's happening in each of those squares and describing that. Now, some squares are more interesting than others, so ignore the boring ones and focus on the more interesting details. So why is there a chair in the middle of the corridor? Might those doors right at the back there be swinging backwards and forwards in this vacant breeze? And you can see what I'd write about the debris on the floor at the front there. So that might be one way of picking out the detail. Here's another example then, this one taken from Frankenstein, and I've deliberately emphasized or highlighted in red some of the hints there that this is going to be quite a dark story, quite a gothic story in total. If you've already got an idea of what your story is going to be, you can plant the seeds of your atmosphere really early on in your story. Here's another example then. In this case, this person is describing their character waking up in a forest. It tickled my skin like a light touch of a loved one's hand, gently flowing down the side of my jaw before melting into the cotton collar, alliteration used. A mosquito buzzed around my ears as I lay there in the undergrowth, traumatized. My eyes shot open, irises zooming into focus, pulse raging inside as adrenaline thrown through my body. The trees above sleepily waved a silent reply. Where was I? What had happened? A mysterious setting there, with lots of interesting vocab choices, building up the sense of mystery of where this person is. Now, in this case, this person actually grabbed the beginning of a TV show as part of their answer. They weren't very creative, so they looked around themselves, flicked on HBO, I think, at the time, and then found this really interesting series. In this case, this is the TV series Lost, and this paragraph is taken from the first couple of seconds of the film. As you can see, you can really guess what might be happening there. He's just about to get up, he's going to walk through those woods and perhaps make a discovery. You can see the film adds quite more detail than my paragraph does, but certainly I've emphasised the fact he's wearing a collar, which means that he's wearing a shirt, which seemed out of place with the setting, again creating that sense of mystery. So have a look at one of your own TV shows you might be watching at home, have a look at the opening, particularly if it's a horror series for example, and think how might you describe that instead if you're stuck for ideas. You'll have noticed so far in this video, or this revision resource, I've tried to use the absolute best words I possibly can. So I've deliberately thought about the word choices I want to use in my work, to really show off to the examiner exactly how good a sort of vocab range I actually have. So words like bad, good, scared, worried definitely should not appear in your response. You need to rethink about what are better words to use there, rather than just the most basic ones you could have done when you were much, much younger. You're trying to use the senses to create a not good response, but a vivid, emotive, sophisticated response to show off to the examiner. Here's a video then from Cooper School, so thank you very much, Cooper School, to kind of guide you through some ideas of how you might achieve that.
Hello, and welcome to this quick video guide on vocabulary choice for your GCSE English. Now, vocabulary choice is one of the single biggest factors which is going to help you to really improve your grade, whatever grade it is you're aiming for. And when you're thinking about your vocabulary, I think what I want you to think about is these guys, the seven dwarves, and I'll explain them in a little bit more detail in a second. But first off, why is vocabulary choice important? Well, it has been proven that students who use a wide vocabulary, who experiment with the language they're choosing, get better marks at GCSE. This is absolute fact. There's no changing it. So you've got to get on board with it. Okay, how are you going to do it? Well, number one, actually, is be confident. Take risks. Don't just go for the simple word. Try and use a word that you wouldn't normally use. Try to show off with the language that you know, because that's really going to impress your examiners. It's also really important to remember that you're going to get more marks for your vocabulary choice than you will for getting your spelling absolutely perfect. Yes, spelling's important, and you've got to do your best with it. But when you sit in the exam hall, you will not know how to spell every single word. But sometimes you're better to experiment with those words anyway, even if you end up spelling them wrong. Okay, the seven dwarfs. Let's get to the bottom of what I'm talking about here, and I'm going to show you a few examples from some of the different AQA GCSE papers, which will hopefully help you to kind of build your vocabulary a little bit. And first of all, we're going to have a look at this question from Paper 2, Section A on Poetry from Other Cultures. The question is, compare the feelings of the poet in Island Man with one other poem. Fairly straightforward, because one thing we know about Island Man is that he is extremely grumpy. Unfortunately, Island Man is Grumpy is not going to get us a particularly good mark, because we've really got to experiment with our vocabulary to make this sound a bit more sophisticated, to make us sound a bit more intelligent. So here's a paragraph that I've written. In Island Man, the poet feels unhappy. Island Man heaves himself another London day. This demonstrates the misery of Island Man's life in London. Nichols' use of the word heaves implies that he is so lethargic and melancholy that he can barely face another agonizing day of despair, desolation and gloom away from his Caribbean home. All of this from that word, grumpy. But check it out, I've just got a few bonus words in here, words that I've thought up that I can use instead of grumpy. And here they are. I've got the word unhappy, I've got the word misery, I've got the word lethargic, melancholy, despair, I've got desolation, gloom, all of them basically implying that he's a pretty miserable, grumpy chap. But I've not just used the one word, I've used as many as I can come up with, and this has helped me to extend my answer, to add more detail to my analysis, and to show off to the examiner. Really useful trick. Let's have another look then. This is a question that you might come across in Paper 1, Section B, Writing to Argue, Persuade or Advise. We've got persuade a friend to give up smoking. Well, obviously, somebody who smokes is dopey. So, instead of saying, you are dopey, I'm going to say something like this. Do you really want people to look at you and think, there goes that idiot who is wasting their life? Don't be a fool. Smoking is not cool. It makes you look like an imbecile, a moron and a halfwit. If you don't have the intelligence to quit for yourself, then just think about the family that you will leave behind when you die. It's always nice to finish on a bit of emotional blackmail, I find, when you're trying to persuade somebody of something. Okay, so we started with dopey, but I've come up with, again, a few other words. I've got the word idiot, I've got the word fool, I've got imbecile, moron, halfwit, and I've also used the antonym, the opposite, in the word intelligence, and I've worked that into my answer too. So again, not just one word. I've spread it out and I've jigsawed these words together to make my answer more detailed, more passionate this time when I'm being persuasive. Okay, one final example for you, and this is from a Paper 2, Section B answer, so I'm looking at writing to describe, and we've got a past question, describe yourself. This is kind of both one of the easiest questions and one of the hardest, depending on which way you look at it, but we're going to describe yourself. In a separate video, I'm going to talk about writing to describe in more detail, and I'm going to tell you very strongly that the last thing you should do for an answer like this is describe yourself. I think you've got to be someone else, because it makes your answer more interesting, but have a look at my other videos to see that one. For now, we're just looking at language choice, so I'm going to describe myself, and you can probably tell, I think of myself as being quite happy. But that on its own is one word. There's not enough detail there. That's not going to make a paragraph of my answer. So instead, I'm going to go with something like this. The successes of my life have left me with one overriding emotion, total and unfettered bliss. I am a joyful person, someone who believes that I deserve the happiness, contentment and pleasure with which life serves me. I am exultant and ecstatic when I look at my future and realise what a jovial place it will be. Okay, again, words coming up in green. I've got bliss, joyful, I've got happiness, obviously happy. I've got contentment, pleasure, exultant, ecstatic, jovial. And again, I've just jigsawed them together. Yes, there are other things on the mark scheme I'm ticking off, like my semicolon, like my use of sentence structures. But ultimately, the heart of it is a good, wide vocabulary. Right. How can you do this for yourself? Well, rule number one I've already said is you've got to be confident. You've got to think of the dwarves because emotions, happy, dopey, sleepy, grumpy, whatever it might be, Doc's not that good, don't worry about him. But the others, they're quite good starting points because we all know quite a lot of different words for those emotions because we use them to describe how we feel the whole time. But number one, students who use a wider vocabulary get better marks. It's a fact. So remember, practice. Practice with a thesaurus. Practice in your writing. Practice in other subjects aside from English, because it's not going to hurt there either. But build that vocabulary before you get into the exam hall. Obviously, there's some ideas in this video which will help, but I can't give you every word in the language. You've got to read, you've got to practice, you've got to get your thesaurus out. An absolute golden rule, take risks, be confident. Thank you.
As you can see then, think about vocab choices isn't just about descriptive writing, it's pretty much any element of the exam answer. To expand on your ideas, it's always a good idea to use synonyms, think about other words that mean the same thing but might actually just a higher range, to really show off to the exam board what you can do. In case you're a bit stuck with vocab choices then, here's a bit of a vocab list for you to use, in this case emphasising the Gothic, so lots of different words that mean mystery, fear, surprise, haste, anger, largeness or indeed darkness. So if you're a bit stuck, please by all means grab some of the words from the board, or sorry, from the video as it currently stands. Okay, here's looking at a student example then. In this case, the exam question was gave the title On the Edge. You can see a description of the two towers or the Twin Towers in the USA, in New York, and they're at the beginning, and then underneath is sort of the action unfolding in paragraph two. You can see I've labelled the different senses and the different techniques being used there throughout this answer. And you can see, you might immediately question, well, how realistic is it? Twin Towers, they disappeared a long time ago, or they fell a long time ago now. But obviously it's a real city this student had actually been to, so they had a good chance of describing the city fairly realistically. And equally, it's not difficult to describe yourself with these gorgeous towers towering above you. So actually it's fairly sort of likely the student could have been there or easily placed themselves there. This isn't like they wrote about themselves being on the moon, for example. So this would have got a grade 6 in total, and obviously the whole thing would be about 2 to 3 sides long. So how could you actually take that answer apart to replicate the same grade? Well, you can see here I've emphasised the different techniques being used. The Twin Towers stood proudly, gives me personification. Giant glass and glinting gives me alliteration. Could be heard as a faint buzz, my reference to senses. Move like bees is obviously a simile. You can see I've deliberately planned my answer to use different devices. So how could I turn this grade 4 answer, based around description of the forest, into a grade 5 or better? Well, in this case, I've split the sentences up. I've put a mark scheme at the side there, and I'd want to add in between the gaps there to add detail to it. So my first sentence deliberately describes rain lashing trees, smashing against them in this horrendous storm. How could I describe that rain against the trees then, or hitting the floor like a torrential downpour, as it says in the answer? Well, I could describe the sheer sheets of water falling from the sky for a start. I could describe how it ran off the leaves, for example. Lightning painted the black sky white as leaves drifted to the ground. How could I emphasize the idea of lighting? Is it like a camera flash going off? Could I add that in the gap next? And then, of course, I've got this idea of lightning crashing to the floor. How could I add to that? Well, I might want to talk about the thunder or the darkness around during this storm. Equally, I could use my description here to emphasize how scared I felt that actually this was a dangerous storm that could cause the end of my life. So lots of ways of adding to this pretty good answer as it is, just to expand the detail. Let's have a look at this detailed description of a setting, in this case of a cliff. You can see in this case the emphasis being on atmosphere, storm clouds gathered in the distance, blackening clouds creeping towards the shoreline, thunder ripped through heaven, its eerie echoes crashing in the gathering gloom. You can see lots more effects in this one. Alliteration used twice there in one sentence. If I looked at this in terms of punctuation, it's got a fairly good range, but I might well request this person to add a bit of stuff in brackets, just to add a little extra punctuation there. And I might look for extended similes or extended metaphors within this response and see what can be added to descriptively, using the higher level descriptive effects to really add to this. So what happens if you're still having trouble? You understand that vocab choice is important, but you're still stuck for ideas. Well, many of you would have already covered the literature exam in your studies, and so would have learned about 14 to 18 poems or quotes in those poems already filled with wonderful vocabulary. Why not take some of these then to your own? So this is a poem called War Photographer. And what I'd look through is interesting word choices in this poem that I can take and use in my own story. You can see I've taken then 100 agonies, faintly, and flesh is grass. I really like those phrases as I felt they were really, really emotive and really engaged me in the story I might want to tell. Then it's just a case of joining the dots. How can I describe my setting using those particular words? This is the answer I came up with then. I ran through the streets, 100 agonies raining down all around me. I could hardly breathe as flesh brushed like grass against my ankles. I faintly heard a woman scream as I rushed on. You can see there the words inputted there into a narrative. So each school gets some feedback from the exam board each time the test is taken. And this is the feedback then from the last time our students took the test. You can see the feedback there for question set A or title A, then B, then C, and then D. I've highlighted in red the areas that apply to setting, and equally, one candidate in green at the bottom there under question set A, the one who wrote about Glastonbury, their own experience of Glastonbury for a memorable weekend, was deliberately commended by the exam board as someone who came up with an original, interesting approach to the question that was also genuine. On the far right, you can now see then the overall summary of their findings. And in this case, we were pinpointed on technical accuracy of the work. They felt there were too many errors, too many spelling errors, too many punctuation errors. And that's something they would want the candidates to look more closely at in the future to improve. So over to you. You can see the criteria at the top there, things I'll be looking for in your work, in columns, imaginative, senses, vocab choices. You can see the question itself on the right hand side, four options to choose from. Please choose one of those to write a response. And then the task I'd like you to complete as part of your revision. You can see there, I'm looking for a setting paragraph, about half a side of A4 long. Picture your setting like a photograph and select details to describe. And remember, you need all the senses to get the absolute best out of this activity. Then check your work for the things mentioned. You can see what I'd be looking for there, and I would like you to complete the activity at the bottom just to check you have indeed got a crackingly brilliant setting paragraph in front of you. Awesome, thank you very much for watching this video then, based around setting.